We want to remind our listeners that this program is for informational and educational purposes only and not intended to substitute for professional veterinary medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. The Animal Medical Center does not recommend or endorse any products or services advertised by Sirius XM.
Welcome to Ask the Vet with Dr. Ann Hohenhaus. This is the place to talk about your pets and get advice from the top veterinarian from the Animal Medical Center in NYC. Hear from the leading authorities on animals and give us a call to ask your questions. Now, here's your host, Dr. Ann Hohenhaus.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining me today on Ask the Vet here on Sirius XM Stars Channel 109. I'm your host, Dr. Ann Hohenhaus. I'm a board-certified internal medicine specialist and oncologist at the Schwarzman Animal Medical Center here in New York City, where the show is coming from. AMC is the largest not-for-profit animal hospital in the world. And thanks to our partnership with Sirius XM Radio, Ask the Vet is also a podcast, and you can download it on any major podcast platform where you get your regular podcasts. Just hunt for Ask the Vet. At the Animal Medical Center, we keep families together by providing the absolute best care for pets. Now, later in the show today, I'm going to answer questions from our listeners. But if you have a question about a pet, you can call and leave us a toll-free message, and I will answer your questions on next month's Ask the Vet program. The number to call is 866-993-8267. And if you don't have a pencil to write that down, don't worry. I'm going to give that number again later on in the show. And now for our trending animal of the month.
It's time for the internet's most talked about animal.
A tiny Jack Russel Terrier named Patron has captured the hearts of people all around the world for his heroic life-saving work in the Ukraine. Patron, the Ukrainian bomb-sniffing dog, and his handler, Mikhailo Iev, of the Civil Protection Service in the Ukraine, were awarded a Medal of Honor from the Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. He was awarded for their extraordinary service to the country. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau was also on hand for the award ceremony. Patron, whose name means ammo in Ukraine, is credited with detecting more than 200 undetonated explosive devices. He was adorned in a pint-sized protective vest and has become an international symbol of patriotism for the Ukrainian people. His exceptionally sweet appearance has catapulted him to a social media platform sensation. When Patron isn't sniffing out explosives, he's out in the community doing charity work or playing and running around with other dogs or eating his favorite treat, cheese. Just Google Patron, the Ukrainian hero dog, to get more information and see photos of this terrific Jack Russel Terrier. It's such a pleasure today to welcome my special guest and fellow Cornellian, Bill Schutt, to Ask the Vet. Dr. Schutt is an emeritus professor of biology at Long Island University Post and a research associate at the American Museum of Natural History. American Museum of Natural History is one of my most favorite places because I will confess that that is where I had my first date with my husband. And we went to look at Chinese dinosaur skeletons and used to spend a lot of Friday nights there when the museum was open late. Dr. Schutt has also written several fascinating books. And today we're going to talk about his most recent nonfiction book, Pump, A Natural History of the Heart. Dr. Schutt was born in New York City and raised on Long Island by parents who encouraged his passion for the natural world. He received a PhD in zoology from Cornell and held the postdoctoral fellowship at the American Museum of Natural History, where he also received a Theodore Roosevelt Memorial Grant. Dr. Schutt has published dozens of articles on topics ranging from terrestrial locomotion in vampire bats to the precarious arboreal copulation behavior of the marsupial mouse. His research has been featured in the New York Times, Newsday, Discover, and The Economist. We have to go back to that. How does the zoologist get in The Economist? He's currently working on a new nonfiction book on teeth, and I've suggested that he come back for Dental Week and talk about that book. And he's also finished the first draft of his solo novel. Welcome to Ask the Vet today. Bill, I'm so glad that you could join me.
All righty. It's really nice to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
So this isn't in the list of questions I'm supposed to ask you, but how did you end up in The Economist?
If I recall I was keeping vampire bats at Cornell for the first time in I think about 30 years. And I was at a mammalogy conference and a reporter for The Economist happened to be there and heard about what I was doing and interviewed me.
Really interesting that they would think it would be interesting and important to write about vampire bats, which I think would be terrific to write about. I have an undergraduate degree, and because I wanted to go to veterinary school, I couldn't be a zoologist and I couldn't be a bio major because going to veterinary school requires a lot of chemistry, physics, and math. And so I have a very artsy-fartsy degree called natural science in order to meet the requirements to go to veterinary school, because otherwise I probably would have been a zoologist, except that you couldn't meet the requirements for that major and still meet the requirements to apply to veterinary school. So anyway, back to your background and topic. So your parents were supportive in your love of nature. So was your like garage or your porch or your kitchen like full of cages and bins of animals?
I don't know if I would describe it like that. I think it was a little bit more organized. So for example, my father, who was a milkman, came home one day and my mother and I had bought a squirrel monkey. And his response to that was he thought the cage was too small. It was sort of a glorified parrot cage. He said, you're gonna have to do something about that. So I wound up building a cage and I really wasn't a builder. So I tried to find something that looked to be about the right size. So I took the measurements of a phone booth and built a cage in the middle of our living room. And that's where Googie lived for 5 years. But I had boa constrictors and lizards and we always had a dog. We've always had birds. So I guess the answer to the question is that, yeah, I did have a lot of pets.
So I'm intrigued because monkeys are very smart. And how did you keep this squirrel monkey in the cage? Because if you weren't much of a builder, I'm going to guess that the squirrel monkey could figure out the flaws in your building technique.
No, it was tight. I got a lot of help. They weren't going to allow me to put something into the living room unless it was, you know, this beautifully stained cherry wood with the drawer. And so my parents helped me out and my father was quite handy. But it was really interesting. Googie never tried to get out. And that my mother named him. That was Googie was short for Guggenheimer. We used to take him on walks. I would get quite a few looks walking down the street with a monkey on a leash. That's a good way to get some attention. But he was fun.
And then, so was he your most interesting pet, or do you think there was something better than a monkey? I'm thinking there's not much better than a monkey as a pet.
Well, I worked in a lot of pet shops, and I wound up having piranha for a number of years, and they were kind of interesting. They're really light sensitive and they're quite timid. But that's another, I've had lungfish. So working in pet shops, I was able to go to the wholesalers and see really kinds of neat freshwater fish, and wind up bringing a lot of them home. I've always had tropical aquaria. And so I would say lungfish and piranha were the two most interesting non-mammals that I've had.
And are piranha, so you said they're timid. So yeah. How do they get, I don't know, I'm thinking I watch Discovery Channel, people be eaten right and left by piranhas. Yeah. Is that a fallacy?
Most people don't get bit by them. It's a matter of, I mean, if there's blood in the water, then they sort of go into a frenzy. But when you've got one or two of them in an aquarium situation, that you don't want to put a light on because they just get, you know, they'll just go slamming into the glass. But they were, unless you were another smaller piranha, they were pretty timid. And if that was the case, if it wasn't the case, then they would eat the smaller one. But I mean, I've had much more aggressive fish than piranhas were.
Oh, we had an African three-toed frog. Mm-hmm. And that thing was like, my husband said, I think the fish must be jumping out of the fish tank. We got to get a lid for it. I said, have you looked at the frog lately? The frog is looking really plump. And yeah. Froggy just demolished $1 million worth of very pretty fish that were in this tank. And this frog lived forever, absolutely forever. And one time he got this thing under his tongue. You could see it when he opened his mouth. And I was like, he's being an oncologist. I was like, oh, Froggy has a tumor. And my husband said, let's get someone who knows more about frogs than you do. And so one of our exotic specialists said, oh, it's probably got an infection in his mouth. So we had to get Froggy out of the tank, weigh him in a plastic box on the kitchen scale, and then get a teeny tiny dose of antibiotics to inject into Froggy's fanny. And that it went away, and he lived 3-4 more years. And I think Froggy finally just died of old age and probably fatness. I mean, he was a robust frog, let me tell you. He probably lived 6-8 years. So he was a terrific frog.
I had a hedgehog once. That was another
we love hedgehogs. We see hedgehogs at the Animal Medical Center with postpartum hypocalcemia, and they get very shaky because their calcium is too low because they're nursing babies. And it's really hard to take care of animals that roll up into a ball every time you try and touch them. But we see a fair number of hedgehogs here as pets. I think they're really cute when they unroll themselves.
Oh yeah. This one's name was Evinrude because you know, the noises that they make, and it sounded like a little motor.
Yeah, and the I think they kind of look like a kitchen scrubber when they're all balled up, but they've got a cute little nose and face. So zoology came naturally to you?
Yeah, I think initially, you know, when I grew up, I was watching Wild Kingdom and the Jacques Cousteau specials. It wasn't like it is today where you can just, you know, turn on a science channel. And so I was really impressed by Jacques Cousteau. I thought I wanted to be a marine scientist. And wound up studying it for about a year and a half at Southampton College, where years later I taught. But somewhere along the way, I got convinced that as an undergrad, I should probably diversify a bit more and then specialize once I went into grad schools. So I switched over to organismal biology, and then went on to study that for a master's degree at SUNY Geneseo. And then years later, went back to school. And when I was accepted to Cornell, I thought that I was going to be working with a professor there on ichthyosaurs, but one of his graduate students sort of pinned me against the wall out in the hallway and said, no, don't do it, don't do it. And she became a really good friend of mine. But luckily, I wound up working with John Hermanson in the vet school at Cornell, who was in the field of zoology. And his love was bats. And so I started working on bats, and with among the 1,400 or so species of bats, nobody was really surprised when I picked the three vampires to do my research on. And I was really lucky because at that time, you know, I was at Cornell from 90 to 95. I'd say 95% of everything that was known about vampire bats was known about one species. And the other two were turned out to be an open book because a lot of people, and I won't name names, but there were a lot of scientists who were the attitude was like a vampire bat is a vampire bat is a vampire bat. What you know about one, you know, the others are going to be the same. And that just turned out not to be the case. And a couple of old timers took me aside when I said, you know, these animals are living in the same, these two species are living in the same place. And you've got this concept of competitive exclusion, where if you have, say, two vampire species living in one area, then one is either going to go extinct, or it's going to adapt, or it's going to move away. And that wasn't the case. So I was able to show that there were big differences between these. The common vampire bat, which is the one that you see on TV and elsewhere, fed mostly on large terrestrial mammals, whereas the white-winged vampire bat, which I was lucky enough to collect and bring back to Cornell, fed on birds. And that's how they sort of partitioned the resources. So from there, it turned into, you know, once I saw those behavioral differences, then it turned into anatomy and evolution, how vampire bats evolved. And eventually that turned into my first book on blood-feeding creatures, Dark Banquet.
Now I've missed that particular one, but I will tell you that I read A Pump from Cover to Cover. And I think that this is something that lots of people can really relate to, because all people have hearts, and hearts cause a lot of problems for people. And so your book really covers the kind of funky hearts that worms have, all the way up to like hearts that are as big as a golf cart, which would be found in something like a blue whale. So can you share some of your favorite stories from that book?
Yeah. First off, I was really surprised when I was asked to write a book about the heart, because I'd written, my first book was about blood feeding creatures, and then cannibalism, and a perfectly natural history was about cannibalism in the animal kingdom, and then sort of transitioning into human history of it, staying away from the sensationalized aspects. But my editor and my agent wanted me to do something a little bit more mainstream. And I initially I thought the heart wasn't for me, because I'm not a cardiologist. I said, this has got to have been done so many times and so well. But they said, well, do some research on it. And what I was able to figure out pretty quickly was that there were dozens and dozens of really interesting stories that I was able to tell about different hearts and circulatory systems in the animal kingdom. And then, like my previous books, transition into medicine and the ancient history and modern history of our knowledge and lack of knowledge about the heart. So I went from sort of demystifying weird, cannibalism and vampirism, to demystifying some things about the heart that, where did this idea of the heart as being the place where the soul is and intellect, where did that come from? And then the neat thing about this book was that, I'd written a book about cannibalism and I'd gotten people who asked me, or blood feeding, and they'd go, well, you worked 30 years on vampire bats. How does it keep my grandmother alive for 5 years longer? And so Pump was a lot more relevant, because the interesting animal stories that I was able to tell had medical relevance, and I made sure that I picked really neat creatures like Burmese pythons and a tropical fish called the zebra fish, and so that list just got longer and longer, and the stories got more interesting. Probably the one that I found the most interesting was, unfortunately, in 2014, 9 blue whales died on the ice up off the coast of Newfoundland. And my friends that work at the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto had specialized in whales, but they really knew very little about the anatomy of blue whales, because they have a tendency to sink when they die. Back in the whaling days, these were not the right whales. The right whales were a bunch of whales, a species of whales that when you threw a harpoon at them and killed them, they would float. Blue whales were not only fast, but when you killed them, they sank.
And so Moby Dick was a right whale.
No, yeah, Moby Dick was the wrong whale for the Pequod, that's for sure. But they were able to make a long story short, they were able to collect the heart of a blue whale that did not sink. It came ashore on a small fishing town on the coast of Newfoundland called Trout River, and it was preserved. They think that it was propped up on the ice for long enough, and the temperature. Well, the conditions that were cold enough that it preserved the organs. So my friends went up there, and this was pretty much a construction operation, heavy equipment, separating the ribs out, and 4 people going into the thoracic cavity to cut the heart free and then push this thing out. But it took 5 years to preserve. And so I go through that process, and they didn't really want to put this thing into the equivalent of a giant bottle of formalin. So they sent it to Germany to be plastinated. And I don't know if you've ever seen the live bodies, the bodies exhibit.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we've got somebody dribbling a basketball and it looks all normal, except he has no skin, that type of thing. So this was the largest project that they'd ever undertaken. And they plastinated this whale heart, and it turned out to be this incredible, incredible specimen, but it was really surprising. It was a lot smaller.
So for listeners out there who maybe haven't thought about what plastination might be, plastination is a technique to preserve living or formerly living specimens and use them to study. So many students learn anatomy from plastinated specimens, which the old method of studying anatomy specimens was kind of like pickling the former living creature in a nasty substance called formalin, which is really not good for any of us, but it preserved stuff really well. And so plastination is like the new very safe method of preserving these anatomy specimens, and they can be spectacularly beautiful as well. And so that's what got done to this whale heart.
So when they finished it, they were really surprised by a lot of things. There were blood vessels. You know, this is a mammal, right? So you figure they know all these organs, all of these blood vessels. There were vessels that they still don't know what they are. And the heart was a lot smaller than they expected. You know, back when they were getting questioned about, well, how, you know, what's the biggest heart in the world? A blue whale heart. How big? Size of an SUV. Well, when they found one and were able to preserve it, it was a whole lot smaller than they thought it would be. You know, weighed in at about 400 pounds. But the example that I use is if you had a 90 ton hummingbird rather than a 90 ton whale, its heart would weigh eight times as much. It would weigh 3,200 pounds. And so why is that? So I got to explore that, you know, that question. And it has to do with the fact that a hummingbird's wings beat at about 80 times per second. In order to supply that muscle, you've got to get more blood to pumped out. One way to do that is to have a high heart rate, 1260 beats per minute.
Is that a hummingbird?
That's a hummingbird heart rate. I think that's about mechanically, that's about as fast as a heart can fill, pump, and then refill. And so the only other way to get blood to the wing muscles is to have a larger heart. So every time the heart beats, it sends more blood out to those muscles.
So the whale then must not need as great a cardiac output as a hummingbird does per kilo.
Absolutely.
If you can even think about a kilo of hummingbird, which a hummingbird is probably, 30, 40 grams. I mean, yeah, they're absolutely tiny.
Their heart's beating maybe 3 to 10 times per minute. And when they dive, maybe even less.
Wow. Incredible. So you mentioned that the vampire bat story doesn't really help grandma live longer. So how does the pump story help grandma live longer?
Well, a couple of the animals that I dealt with, for example, and this has become, the tropical zebra fish has become the new guinea pig. You probably know that.
Yes.
And so there's one aspect of it that ties into cardiology, into cardiac research, is the fact that you can snip off 20% of a ventricle of a tropical zebrafish, and it will grow back. A clot will quickly form. The connective tissue will sort of can form around that wound. And then previously adult myocytes, cardiac muscle cells, will start to reproduce. And now you've got this completely healed heart. Well, as you know, that's just not the case with humans. So for example, if we have a heart attack and blood has been denied to a certain region because a coronary artery has been blocked, so that tissue that's downstream of that artery can be starved for oxygen and nutrients and die. And when it and when it heals, it comes back as scar tissue, not contractile tissue. So what is it about the zebrafish heart that allows it to repair itself where a human heart can't repair itself? So there's a lot of research right now going on to figure out what it is and how we might be able to stimulate myocytes in a human to go back into their reproductive stage. So we're not talking about growth from things like stem cells. We're talking about adult non-reproductive heart muscle that actually goes back into its reproductive stage again. So how do you stimulate that to take place?
So the zebrafish heart cells that are adult cells go backwards and become immature heart cells and can make a whole, can fix up this damaged heart, where our heart cells just make a giant scar.
they seem to migrate to that wound region and then go into a reproductive stage. And it's the same thing with collagen producing cells that produce the sort of connective tissue, a scaffold upon which these muscle cells will be fitting themselves.
So let's shift a little bit. And, you know, New Yorkers love the Museum of Natural History. And, you know, there's probably not a room in that museum that I don't love to go back for like the 40th time. I'm sure my child says, "Ugh, do we have to go again, Mom?" But what's it like to work there in that those beautiful turrets and that old sandstone building?
It's wonderful. I mean, and I've been there since I was a graduate student in Cornell. So I've been there off and on as a PhD student when I was doing my work on bats, then as a postdoc, then as a research associate. And it's amazing. And I'm incredibly lucky because if I'm not working on my own research, which I haven't done a whole lot recently, once I started to write these books, I'm dealing with some of the top scientists in the world. So not only is it a great place to get interviews with experts, but it's also a place where conversations with my colleagues and with my mentor, Nancy Simmons, who still works there, will give me new ideas about what to do next and where I might take either a novel or a nonfiction. That's happened over and over and over again. So, you know, I'll go in and brainstorm Piltdown Man with some of the experts in the field for a novel that I'm working on.
So, you know, I think of the museum as having like dinosaurs and stuffed elephants and things. So how did you, what was there that you could study about vampire bats?
Well, their collections on the fifth floor and elsewhere, you know, they have a study collection that the public that does not get to see. This is when researchers say apply to visit to the museum. They come in and they are able to go to sometimes very large rooms that have collections. Some of them are study skins which is a way to prep animals, mammals mostly. Others are liquid specimens. They're preserved in an alcohol or in the old days it was formalin. But you're able to access, in some instances, hundreds of specimens of the species that you happen to be working on. So this is, like I said, this is something that a lot of the public don't realize, you know, when they don't get up to the fifth floor and they don't get into these state-of-the-art storage facilities that have such an amazing, amazing collection. And I was able to, I'm able to access those when I need to look at something.
So, like hearts, for example.
Yeah. Right. Or bat specimens, for example, mm-hmm. or talk to somebody about leeches, a leech expert, or as I mentioned, a lot of my friends are sort of archaeologists, and so I've been doing a lot of that. I do a lot of history in my book, so I'm in there picking their brains about historical aspects, things that took place at the museum 100 years ago. And they still have collections. You know, I can walk into a room and here are elephant skulls that were collected by Teddy Roosevelt. So it's really something that I never take advantage of, and I'm always incredibly grateful that I'm able to be there.
Teddy Roosevelt was incredible, and I read a book about him and the national parks and how he would save places that were of great importance to the country, partly because he was a naturalist at heart and liked to do things like save elephant skulls and go out west to Yellowstone and the Badlands and things. So that book about him and the national parks is a really, really interesting book. It's almost more about, although his name's in the title, it's almost more about the national parks than it really is about Teddy Roosevelt and how a lot of our national parks actually came to be. He was a good person in that sense. He was interested in preserving things like that. So the next book you're doing is on teeth. So I just want to remind our listeners out there that last month we had AMC's dentist on the Ask the Vet show, and he and one of our surgeons talked about doing a root canal on a jaguar at the Animal Medical Center. And if you're interested in the teeth x-rays of the jaguar getting the root canal, they're on our website. You just need to put Rico, R-I-C-O, in the search bar, and you can see pictures of Rico's broken fang. He broke one of his big canine teeth, and you can see also on the x-rays why they didn't pull that tooth and why they did a root canal instead, because that baby is big. What you see on the outside of that cat's head is a tooth that goes way inside that cat's head. I can't imagine what it would be like to pull a tooth on a jaguar. And so Rico got a root canal while he was here. So we just have a couple of minutes left. What's the best tooth you've heard about so far?
Well, right now I'm writing the chapter on narwhals. They're kind of interesting.
Is that a tooth, that thing?
Yeah, it's a tusk. Yeah. And it's really neat because there's only one of them, or sometimes there's none. So I'm in the middle of that right now, working with a friend of mine from the Royal Ontario Museum. But this is very much like the cannibal book and like tooth, where I go through the animal kingdom and I look at the evolution of teeth, and I consider teeth to be one of the key innovations that ever evolved in creatures. I think that's a no-brainer. But to go through the animal kingdom and look at how they're used, and now how they're used by humans, you know, because they're a very, very common fossil. But then to look at early dentistry, things like, like tooth transplants back in the 1817 and 1800s. I go into George Washington's dentures, where there's been a real controversy about the fact that his dentures may have been made of slaves' teeth, and I got to go in and talk to the real experts and get the lowdown on that question. And that's sort of the opening chapter. That's the equivalent of the blue whale part, is this whole controversy about George Washington's dentures. You know,
so his dentures really at Mount Vernon?
Yeah, two pairs of them are. He probably had about five pairs over his lifetime. By the time he was 50, he had no teeth left.
I think that was common in 1776, wasn't it?
No doubt. But it wasn't the people who had money who could actually get dentures made. You know,
people say that that's why he never smiles in any portrait, is because he had teeth issues.
Yeah, when you see his full set of dentures and just how unwieldy they are, you can't imagine what it would be like to have that in your mouth. So it's really not a surprise. And a number of his portrait artists commented on it. So you can read them talking about the fact that his face was all swollen from having these things in there. And you know, just one little tidbit here is they were not being able, he wasn't able to use these teeth for eating. They were pretty much for show. When you're the most important person in arguably in the world, and you need to show yourself as the leader of this new country, then you can't be doing it with no teeth in your mouth. So a lot of this was for, to make him look good,
but not to eat. That is an incredible tidbit. So I want to say that Bill Schutt will be the featured guest on AMC's next Animal Lovers Book Club. He's going to talk more about his book Pump with me. It'll be held over Zoom on June 30th at 6 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. And if you would like to join us and hear Bill and I expand on this conversation about hearts, and we also will take questions from the audience during that event. So all you have to do is go to www.amcny.org/usedanevents. Registration is free, but you don't get the Zoom link unless you register. So my sincere thanks to Bill for joining me today on Ask the Vet, and I look forward to continuing this conversation.
Thank you very much. It was a real pleasure to be here.
So much fun. I'd be happy to talk zoo animals all the time. Thanks. And if you've got a question about your pet's health, just call and leave me a message, and I'll answer your questions next month on Ask the Vet. The toll-free number is 866-993-8255. 8267. And stay tuned, because after the break, I'll have the animal news.
We're back with Dr. Ann Hohenhaus on Ask the Vet. Call now with your pet questions on Sirius XM Stars.
Welcome back to Ask the Vet here on Sirius XM Stars Channel 109. And now it's time for the animal news.
It's time for animal headlines, the biggest animal news from across the world.
June is Adopt-a-Cat Month, and so this story is for all those adding a furry feline to their family this month. Ooh, that's a lot of Fs in a row. I have an amazing story for you about Simon. Simon's a beautiful black, nearly six-year-old Bombay cat. For those of you who haven't seen a Bombay cat, Bombay cats are all black. They got black whiskers, black lips, and black paw pads. And Simon is extraordinary because he loves hiking, rock climbing, kayaking, biking, sailing, snowboarding, skiing, sledding, and swimming with his dad, JJ Yosh. Yosh adopted the now 10-pound feline in 2016 when he was just a few weeks old, and soon started taking him on hikes and other outdoor activities as a way to safely introduce the little guy to the outdoors. Yosh's bond with Simon grew stronger with every experience. And over the last several years, this dynamic duo went rock climbing and kayaking in Colorado, whitewater rafting in the Sacramento River near Lake Tahoe, so beautiful, sailing on Clinton Lake in Kansas, camping and rappelling in the canyons of Death Valley National Park, and even on a road trip from Boulder to the Florida Keys. Yosh carries Simon on his shoulders when he gets tired. So what that means, folks, is that this cat walks until he gets tired, which I don't really think of cats voluntarily walking anywhere. But that's how Simon earned the name Backpacking Kitty. The twosome are always together. Yosh calls Simon his soulmate and guardian angel and says Simon will do anything for a piece of food. If you're interested in following this pair on their adventures through the outdoors, you can follow their adventures on Twitter. And Yosh's Twitter handle is at JJ Yosh, J-J-Y-O-S-H. And you can see pictures of both JJ and Simon. Our second story today is about another black animal, except this is a black Labrador named Max. He's been hailed as a hero because he helped rescuers find his owner after a three-day search of a wooded 2,700-acre gorge in Bush Park in Katy, Texas. Max's mom, Sherry Nope, was recently diagnosed with dementia, but as always, she went out for her daily walk with Max. But this time she didn't come back. For 3 days, Max never left his mom's side, despite excessive heat and rain. Finally, on the third day, a group of volunteers who were searching for Sherry heard Max barking in the woods and discovered Max and Sherry. Before this ordeal, Max had a sentimental connection to the family because he belonged to one of Sherry's sons who had passed away 2 years earlier. Now that bond is even stronger, and thankfully, Sherry is doing well, as is hero Max, who got a clean bill of health and a much-needed bath after his three-day ordeal. In our third news story, this is actually my favorite one, even though it's not a cat. A three-month-old baby giraffe got a little pep in her step thanks to the wildlife health and care teams at the San Diego Zoo Safari Park and a pair of specialized graphite orthotic braces that attach to her front legs. Mitsuni, which means in the forest in Swahili, was born with a disorder that caused the little giraffe's front legs to bend improperly, making it nearly impossible for her to stand up and walk. She now has giraffe-patterned orthotic braces made by a local clinic that typically makes prosthetics for humans. This was the first time the company ever made a prosthetic device for wildlife. I'm thinking probably the first time they made a prosthetic device for a giraffe as well. According to Dr. Matt Kinney, who's the senior veterinarian at the San Diego Parks Wildlife Safari, said that without these life-saving braces to provide support to her legs, Mitsuni's legs would soon have become increasingly more painful and progressed to a point where she would not be able to overcome her disability and actually walk. Happily, the treatment with these orthotic braces is succeeding, and Mitsuni is growing to a healthy weight and height and is settling in with the rest of her herd in the 60-acre San Diego Zoo Safari Park. If you'd like to see this little Mitsuni and her giraffe leg braces, just Google baby giraffe in leg braces for more information and photos. I'd also like to take a moment to tell you about our notes from the ER video. It's an intimate look at the day in the life of a seasoned emergency veterinarian and my colleague, Dr. Carly Fox, who has been a guest on this show and is also a fellow Cornellian like Dr. Schutt. You get a sneak peek at some of Dr. Fox's interesting cases, a cat who fell from a high-rise building, a dog who got into a scuffle with a porcupine. In 2021, AMC's Emergency and Critical Care Service provided life-saving treatment to 22,000 patients, about 160 patients each day. And all of these patients were treated under our roof by specialists working together across 20 specialties and services. Just go to www.amcny.org and search Notes from the ER. If you have a pet health question, just pick up the phone and leave me a message. It's that simple. I'll answer your questions on next month's Ask the Vet. The number to call is 866-993-8267. And now we're going to take some calls from our listeners. The first call is from Carly in Nevada.
My name is Carly. I live in Nevada, south of Carson City. I have a little schnauzer who's about 11, 12 years old, sweet little dog, she's perfect, but she has itchy skin. And about every 3 months, she gets an allergy shot, but sometimes she needs one before that, and I just hesitate to give her that many shots. I bathe her with shampoo that I've gotten from the pet supply that's supposed to be good, and I've even read and put baking soda, just sprinkled baking soda and rubbed it in, which seemed to help sometimes. But do you have any other suggestions? Thank you very much.
So, Carly, your little itchy schnauzer is like a lot of dogs in New York City right now. Everyone seems to be very itchy and have an ear infection. And that's probably because itchiness in the skin of dogs is a manifestation of allergies. Carly mentioned that her little schnauzer is getting an allergy injection about every 3 months. Now, I don't know what injection that is, but the one we use at the Animal Medical Center is an injection that can be given every month. And I find that dogs often need several monthly injections in a row, and then we can space them out a little bit. So if in fact, the schnauzer is getting the allergy injection that can be given every month, I would suggest that Carly stick to that monthly schedule for a little while and see if more frequent injections might actually help the schnauzer be less itchy. The other things to think about are, does the schnauzer have fleas? Fleas can make some dogs very itchy. Although having never practiced veterinary medicine in Nevada, I'm not sure that fleas are that common out there, but they're certainly common here and make dogs very itchy. Shampooing dogs can bring some relief, especially if you use a gentle shampoo your veterinarian recommends, but I don't know if baking soda wouldn't just simply dry the skin out and make things more itchy. I've never really used that in dogs. So I would stick with what my veterinarian recommended. The other thing to consider is if your veterinarian is stymied as to what to do for the itchy schnauzer, then I would suggest maybe that Carly look for a skin specialist, a dermatologist for dogs. And she can find that by going to a website, which is www.American College of Veterinary Dermatology, ACVD. dermatologist.org, and that will list dermatologists, and you can search in there for one close to you. There are allergy vaccines that can be made for dogs, and dogs can be tested for allergies, and it may be that the Schnauzer needs some sort of advanced allergy management besides the regular monthly shots that typical veterinarians like me would use. So I hope, Carly, that helps and that the Schnauzer is soon on the road to be mended and not so itchy. Our next call is from Jamie.
Hi, the question is for Ask a Vet. My name is Jamie. I live in DC. I have a dog who's 13 and she's having a lot of issues with her legs, not being able to go up the stairs and give out. The vet just diagnosed her with diabetes. So we're trying to understand from him what the medicine insulin situation would be. Question is the only way, why do dogs get diabetes? And I've never heard of that. And will the insulin, will I have to give that to her every day? And will that help her legs improve at all? Thank you so much. Bye.
Oh, Jamie, I'm sorry that your dog is so sick. I think that the diabetes could be the cause of the weak back legs, because when you have diabetes, you don't feel very good. And so you might be weak, not because there's anything wrong with your legs, but you feel lousy. The treatment of diabetes in dogs is to give insulin. And unlike cats, who sometimes seem to recover from their diabetes, once a dog is diabetic, it seems to need insulin every day for the rest of its life. Oftentimes it takes twice a day to give insulin to dogs. And oftentimes a dog needs to eat a special diet to help keep their blood sugar in control. The reason that dogs get diabetes, there's a bunch of different reasons. So one would be that the dog had a disease called Cushing's disease. And that's where the body makes too many steroids, and the steroids make the body resistant to insulin effects. So treating the Cushing's disease will make the diabetes easier to control. Pancreatitis, or inflammation of the pancreas, can cause diabetes because the pancreas is where insulin is made. And if the pancreas is inflamed, it may not be able to make enough insulin. And so you have to give insulin by injection. Treatment of a dog with steroids for a disease can also make them resistant to the effects of insulin, and therefore the animal becomes diabetic. And then finally, there are some breeds that are predisposed to diabetes, and so it may be a breed predisposition. The dog could also be weak in the hind because diabetes will often cause dogs to lose weight. And so this dog could be weak in the hind because it's lost a lot of muscle mass. So I think, Jamie, that unfortunately you're going to need to treat your dog with insulin for the rest of their life. And so I hope that goes well. Really, most dogs adapt very well to that situation. And when we come back from the break, we will have news from the Animal Medical Center.
We're back with Dr. Ann Hohenhaus on Ask the Vet. Call now with your pet questions on Sirius XM Stars.
Welcome back to Ask the Vet, and I have news from the Animal Medical Center. AMC's USDAN Institute for Animal Health Education has created a pet health library so that pet parents everywhere can access accurate and trusted pet health information for free. The Pet Health Library is the leading online user-friendly platform with information verified by veterinary experts at the Schwarzman Animal Medical Center. Pet parents everywhere can also attend the USDAN Institute's free monthly virtual pet health events and receive a free weekly newsletter with useful pet tips and information. The USDAN events are recorded and are archived on AMC's website, so you can watch previous health events as well as Book Lovers Club, all on the AMC website, which is amcny.org. Put events in the search bar. The next event coming up is Kidney Disease in Pets, and that will be held June 15th at 6 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Dr. Navid Edidali, who's the service head of hemodialysis and extracorporeal therapies at the Schwarzman Animal Medical Center, will discuss treatment of kidney disease in pets and help pet parents recognize the signs and learn how to care for their pet who has kidney disease. As always, registration is free and is required for all USDAN events so that you get the Zoom link. Please visit amcny.org to sign up for Dr. Edidali's Kidney Disease in Pets. At the same time, don't forget that you can sign up to hear my guest from today's show, Dr. Bill Schutt, and I talk about Pump, his book on the heart of animals from worms to humans, actually. I'd like to thank Dr. Schutt for being my special guest today here on Ask the Vet, and I'd like to thank the listeners and callers and to everyone who's downloaded Ask the Vet. I really appreciate your support for our podcast. Don't forget, if you have a question about your pet's health, just call and leave me a message on our toll-free number and I'll answer your question next month here on Ask the Vet. The number to call is 866-993-8267. Don't forget to check us out on social media. Facebook is The Animal Medical Center, Twitter and Instagram at AMCNY. And be sure to subscribe to the Ask the Vet podcast wherever you get your podcasts. I'll be back next month here on Ask the Vet on Channel 109. Thank you and have a great month, everyone.